everyone. The Coordinating Center for the National Drug Early Warning System, sponsored by the National Institute on Drug Abuse, is pleased to welcome you to our first of two NDUS Presents webinars in July. The NDUS PI, Dr. Eric Wish, and our NIDM project scientist, Moira O'Brien, are both in the audience with us this afternoon. My name is Erin Artigiani, NDUS COI. Barbara Kerr, Marwa Al-Nasir, and I will be the facilitators for this webinar. We are part of the NDUS Coordinating Center team based at CSER at the University of Maryland College Park. This webinar is a co-production with the Maryland ROTA Project, Rural Opioid Technical Assistance Project. So we are also joined today by the Maryland ROTA Project Coordinator, Lara Bonilla, and she will help facilitate this webinar as well. We developed the NDUS Presents webinars to work with leading substance abuse experts to explore emerging drugs and timely drug-related topics. Maryland ROTA webinars focus on the opioid crisis in Maryland and state and local approaches to addressing it. Today, we are excited to be joined by the lead researchers on the statewide ethnographic assessment of drug use and services, SEEDS project. Our first presenter will be Dr. Danielle Germain from Johns Hopkins University's Bloomberg School of Public Health. She will be followed by Dr. Andrea Lopez from the University of Maryland's Department of Anthropology. For those who are interested, you can find recordings of our prior webinars and invitations to future webinars on our website at ndews.org, ndews.org. You will also find instructions for how to join our NDUS network and participate in ongoing discussions with approximately 2,000 experts and concerned citizens from across the United States and many other countries. Lara?
Welcome, everyone. I'm Lara Bonilla, and as Erin mentioned, I am the Maryland ROTA Project Coordinator. Maryland ROTA is part of an initiative by the Substance Abuse and Mental Health Services Administration established by the University of Maryland in partnership with local and state organizations. A project aims to strengthen the capacity of rural communities in Maryland by helping our communities identify, understand, and respond to the opioid misuse epidemic. Our multi-pronged approach includes delivering evidence-based training, providing current information and education, and strengthening youth against opioid misuse. For example, we encourage you to join our ROTA network to learn about best practices, ask questions of peers and experts, and share your local experiences. More information about Maryland ROTA and a link for joining our network are available at www.marylandrota.org. This webinar will be approximately 60 minutes long, and we encourage you to submit questions during and after the presentation. Please do not raise your hand. Instead, we ask that you please post your questions in the Q&A box. We will hold a Q&A session after the presentation. We will do our best to get to all of your questions, and we will try to address any remaining questions after the webinar. A recording of this webinar will be made available on both websites, www.ndews.org and www.marylandrota.org. Thank you, and we hope you enjoy this NDUS ROTA webinar. Dr. Lopez, I'll hand it over to you.
Thank you so much both to NDUS and also everyone at Maryland ROTA for having us. So I'm gonna start off with just some introduction to our study, and then we'll sort of get into some results, and then we'll have time for the Q&A. So today, as was mentioned, we're going to be discussing results of our statewide ethnographic assessment of drug use and services. This was a study that we conducted in every county in the state of Maryland over the course of 2019. So our study was funded by the Maryland Department of Health through Centers for Disease Control and Prevention Crisis Response Funds. And so we did direct collaboration with them while also collaborating between two institutions. So myself at the University of Maryland in College Park, and then Dr. Danielle Germain at the Bloomberg School of Public Health at Johns Hopkins University. We conducted our study actually in every county with the exception of Baltimore City. So 23 counties throughout Maryland. We had our sort of regional divisions split up into these kind of regions, which include West, Central, East, and South. And so the Johns Hopkins team was responsible for regions 1 through 4. And you can see all of the individual counties that are included in those regions. And then myself and my UMD team were responsible for region 5, South. And those are our 5 counties that are listed there. in this PowerPoint. So I won't read them all now, but we'll sort of discuss a little bit more later as we get into data. Many people have asked, and we, you know, in this initial conversation with the Maryland Department of Health, so why seeds and why now? So we started out with the idea that Maryland is very diverse. So in terms of geography, in terms of culture, in terms of demographic profiles of residents. So we've got over 6 million people living in 24 county jurisdictions. And there really was a lack of information about people who use drugs and frontline stakeholders outside of Baltimore City. So there was sort of a lack of information about things happening out of Baltimore City where there had been much more research. So this study, the logic was really that we needed to get localized data that was really sort of responsive to things that were going on in different local contexts in Maryland. And that we wanted to ensure that ongoing strategies to address issues related to drug use were locally relevant and locally sustainable. So the idea behind our study design and methodology was really to say local context and place really matter. And so what does it mean sort of to have a proof of concept about how you can follow the same sort of research questions, but really in every single county, which have these sort of wide diversity of needs and wide diversity of positions where they are sort of relative to what's happening with drug use in those communities. So we had four general goals for SEEDS. The first one was to characterize drug use experiences and patterns, and then factors also contributing to mortality and morbidity. The second was to characterize existing service capacity related to drug use and harm reduction. The third was to identify service gaps and approaches to addressing those gaps. And then finally, the fourth was to assess the potential capacity for expansion of harm reduction services. And again, this is in relationship to many different places across the state being at different parts in kind of their timeline of the types of harm reduction services that had been implemented. So we wanted to sort of say, well, where is everyone? And then potentially, are there things sort of from across the state that people can sort of share in terms of information about the different sort of places people were at on those timelines? So I'll outline briefly our methods. So we began first with an initial rapid ethnographic assessment. And so we did this to really identify sites for recruitment and stakeholder engagement and to establish relationships. And this really sort of included some of the traditional ethnographic methods of, you know, doing a bunch of research, driving around these different places, getting an orientation of the kind of local geography in terms of services and other places where people who use drugs might spend their time. We followed that up by an orientation interviews with county health officers, key staff, and other stakeholders. And again, this was really important to us because we wanted to be able to say, you know, we're not outside researchers that are coming in and not engaging with what is already happening. So we wanted to sort of forge those partnerships and say, you know, we are collaborating with the Maryland Department of Health and we are here to sort of understand what's already happening. And then from that place begin recruitment of our different populations. So we did recruitment for semi-structured interviews with an extremely diverse set of stakeholders who worked on issues related to drug use. And then we also recruited people who use drugs for semi-structured interviews. And again, we were just discussing this earlier, you know, for a qualitative study, the sample size here is extremely robust. So in regions 1 through 4, the Hopkins team had 220 participants who were stakeholders. And in UMD region 5, we had 50 stakeholders. And then for our sample of people who use drugs for regions 1 through 4, we had 240 participants. And in region 5, we had 72. So that's over 600, I think it's 602 people who actually participated in a qualitative study in a pretty short punctuated time frame. So I think the total time that we were actually in the field doing data collection was a total of about 4 to 5 months. And so you can imagine, as you know, you'll see our acknowledgement slide later, we had extremely sort of large teams that were working around the clock on this project. So all of our study activities were approved by both institutional review boards at Johns Hopkins School of Public Health and also the University of Maryland. So I'll turn it over to Dr. Germain now to talk about the findings from regions 1 through 4.
Thanks, Andrea, and really appreciate the opportunity to be here with everybody today to talk about this work. The regions that we worked in cover 18 counties stretching from Appalachian Western Maryland across a primarily rural region, counties that surround Baltimore City, cross the Chesapeake Bay and stretch all the way to Delaware and to the Atlantic Ocean. So an extremely diverse combination of counties that were really fantastic to be able to work in. Because of the scope of the project, we're not able to tell you everything that we've learned. So what we decided to do is, so we'll give you a bit of a snapshot of the findings within each of the different themes and kind of talk you through a key finding within each one. This shows you the general range of data collection that we did across our counties. And what I would ask for you to take away from this slide is that by and large, across all of the counties, we did a similar amount of data collection with a similar proportion of stakeholders and people who use drugs, with a higher proportion of data collection in larger sized counties and a little bit of diversity depending on the stage of data collection. So this is what our overall sample of participants looked like among the sample of people who use drugs. And so the majority of people were between 30 and 50, but a nice representation of people younger than that and older than that. About half and half people who identified as men or women, and close to 80% identified as white non-Hispanic, and slightly over 20% identifying as persons of color. About half had reported injection drug use in the past year, and then to the right, you see the distribution of the types of drugs that people reported, and in general, a pretty diverse range of types of drugs. So among non-injection drugs, the most commonly reported was crack use, but very high proportion heroin, painkillers, cocaine, a variation of methamphetamine by region. Among injection drugs, certainly the highest concentration of people reporting heroin use, very high reports of fentanyl and cocaine, and sort of a variation of others, again, varying primarily geographically. Next slide, please. One back, yeah. So within the first kind of combination of topic areas, so among drug use patterns and experiences, some of the central things that really emerged here were that there were in fact identifiable patterns of drug use and trajectories that emerged somewhat clearly across the different regions. With a lot of reflections on stressors and contextual factors surrounding initiation and sort of across people's drug use over time. We did hear a lot about shifting and emergent drug use trends and some specific geographic aspects of that. So methamphetamine certainly having more so of a presence in parts of the Eastern Shore, in parts of Western Maryland, much less so in the center, but some emergent shifting there, and very clear sense that fentanyl existed everywhere across all drug types and sort of commonly appreciated in that respect. We heard a lot about mobility related to accessing drugs quite a lot in regards to proximity or transport to and from Baltimore City or into Delaware and the sort of meaning and implications of transportation and geographic borders in that regard. And then a very clear pattern of experiences of mental health challenges, experiences of trauma, and stigma playing quite centrally in people's experiences overall. And I'll talk about that one in a bit more detail on the next slide. So you'll see the same pattern as we continue forward. So for each of these categories of findings, then what we've done here is chosen one of the themes, and then we'll kind of show you a little bit of what the data said there, highlight some of the experiences that give some more depth to those to the data points, and then sort of hopefully show you a little bit how that led into some of the recommendations that emerged from this work. So in regards to the theme of a really resonant sense that mental health trauma and stigma all had very powerful roles in people's lives. Essentially, what we heard consistently is surrounding people's experiences of initiation and their patterns of use over time, that there were experiences of intergenerational drug use that that were tended to be common, tended to be powerful in people's histories, and experiences of trauma that emerged in lots of different aspects of people's lives produced experiences of grief and coping that were challenging, and quite a lot of discussion of experiences of stigma among communities and in structural contexts, most notably in interactions with law enforcement and healthcare settings. So the quotes that are here, the first one is an example of an individual describing his experience with his parents having used drugs and in fact losing them to overdose and being introduced to heroin by his father. The second quote is a reflection of the power of community stigma as a barrier to disclosure or feeling like access to services is even an option. And this is something that we heard quite a bit for people in smaller towns, that the being very protective of disclosure of drug use because that disclosure doesn't go away over time, that within small communities that that information stays with people. And so what we highlighted from this was the need for mental health counseling, trauma-informed care across lots of different types of services, treatment, but also social services. A lot of need for attention to family relationships, potentially as sources of support, but also challenges. And in regards to the community stigma, that the appreciation of the complexity and the social dimensions that tend to underlie people's drug use trajectories could be helpful in enhancing the community understandings of what this lived experience is and potentially point to some opportunities for providing support earlier. And then certainly, and we could spend an entire hour talking about this, but the need for stigma reduction in all of these different contexts as a very clear barrier that people are experiencing. So within service capacity and the gaps therein, one of the things that we heard quite centrally is the power and importance of peers and peer recovery specialists and how important it has been for people's lives to have people who have shared lived experience and being able to provide sort of a welcoming connection within opportunities for resources and learning about options within different communities. There's a lot more to say about so essentially this sort of need for continued sort of support and career development within that area, but certainly a strong voice in favor of the value of that from the perspective of people who use drugs. We also heard quite a lot about the value of organizational partnerships and multidisciplinary networks, and this is particularly the case in the smaller counties and in counties that have sort of a regional connection across counties, that these networks are extremely valuable for sharing resources and being able to sort of balance across geographies what options are available for people within any of those jurisdictions. It also feeds into some of the mobility that we heard quite a bit about. And then the sort of range of availability and access to different types of treatments and other non-treatment social service and social supports varied quite a bit. And so some of what we heard in here was in regards to MAT and people's experiences and challenges, and I'll talk about that a bit more. Heard a lot about need for specific types of services and the relative value of having embedded mental health services within different types of treatment programs. Heard a lot about where transportation and access to housing and employment fits in, and a quite powerful voice, especially in specific regions, that the experience of stigma in regards to being on MAT in some areas didn't differ at all from experiences of stigma associated with being an active user, and in a lot of cases created additional challenges that were that were difficult in sustaining someone's treatment progression or experience. So here I'm going to go into a bit more depth in the availability and types of treatments that were available, because this is a large geography. We heard a lot, and so in general, there was a really strong appreciation that MAT programs have become very much more available, are a super critical part of the treatment landscape. People very much appreciate the extent to which they have become available. What varies quite a bit is the type of model, the type of MAT that's available, and what's available in any one particular county. And the extent to which people feel like they have support or access to information for finding the programs that are available to them within their county, figuring out how to access the ones that are not available in their own county but are available elsewhere, and what is a good fit for them given their own life circumstances. And so I could have given you lots and lots of examples of that diversity, but instead chose to highlight that we also heard quite a lot of positive descriptions of programs that that people were appreciating. And so what we have is a quote here of a woman describing a really fantastic program from her perspective that was providing their treatment supports, but also resources for medical services, for social services, for getting a job, for getting transportation, all of those kinds of things. There was a clear need for targeted programming specific to women and for people who have children, and a powerful voice for both men and women who are primary caregivers for children, talking about the need for supports in accessing treatment for people who are primary caregivers. And then, you know, there are certain counties that that have relatively little or no access to residential or transitional services and or extreme limitations in that regard, and a lot of frustration in that, particularly from the people within those counties wanting to provide a comprehensive scope of services. So what you see in the quotes is that as primarily women who are primary caregivers may not pursue a treatment program if they can't bring their children, and there aren't a lot of, or particularly many, programs where children can be part of the program. And the challenge, if there isn't a transitional option and people are going back to their home community, and the challenges that are experienced there. Transportation came out loudly in regards to access to treatment programs in particular, as well as the challenges in housing and employment and this MAT stigma, all exacerbating people's challenges in engaging with treatment and support services. And so our recommendations here were essentially to tackle those that combination of things. So the attention to the reach, the variety of types of programs, the comprehensiveness of programs, and the ability to tackle social issues, and to really think about where transportation fits in. So in this third area, then we, as Andrea mentioned, Dr. Lopez, we the counties were at very different stages in their harm reduction implementation, and we heard that. And we heard people sort of struggling with that and with the sort of stage of implementation or where they thought they might be going. So a lot of range in perspectives for harm reduction, with some counties being very far, very sort of harm reduction forward, and others appreciating the health value and really pessimistic about the environment in terms of climate for supporting advanced harm reduction activities. We did hear a lot about specific harm reduction services, which I'll talk about the one in particular. But a lot of sense that people have developed their own locally specific approaches and really wanting to know more about what's happening elsewhere, and feeling like they are creating their own strategies, and that there could be some more partnership and sort of shared development in that regard, and a broad sense that that drug users could be, depending on the perspective, there were a lot of voices from stakeholder perspectives of wanting to have more input and understanding of drug users, and from drug users, a really strong sense of wanting to be part of the strategizing and planning. And so this will just highlight the theme for in regards to naloxone and the sort of scope of challenges that people are experiencing in regards to overdose prevention. And so quite clearly, overdose and experiences with revivals and the grief associated with loss and the experience of overdose and revival were extremely, extremely common. And so this is a quote of just one example of referring to having revived a fiance multiple times, having had her own experiences, and in fact, a sort of heartbreaking moment at the end where in fact she lost her fiance and has some residual guilt for that. We heard quite a lot about the sense that having access to naloxone and being able to be part of a revival is something that people are grateful for being able to do for their loved ones, but also the grief and pain of the experience. Naloxone itself was considered to be fairly broadly available, although it did vary across counties, and the steady continued access was where there was much more of a challenge. And so people talked about needing to use, in any given reversal, there was a need most often to use more than a single amount. And that may or may not be what's available. A lot of people would be getting their first access of naloxone through a specific mechanism, either through treatment program or having gone to a specific training. And it was the replacement that they had much more challenge, particularly people who got their first dose at a treatment program, because then they needed to acknowledge that need back to the treatment program. And so that was the challenge that people described. And certainly that stigma in regards to drug use and in regards to overdose and the way that manifests within law enforcement and with healthcare, functioning very much as a barrier still for people being willing to engage and call for support services during an overdose. And so I'll just conclude this section by highlighting that our recommendations emerging from that are both that there's a need to maximize access, specifically thinking about what people who use drugs need, and that they themselves have really powerful and brilliant insights in how to do that. The Good Samaritan law is appreciated, but there's certainly more that needs to be done in regards to the way in which stigma continues to create barriers. And then the need for peer and engagement of people who use drugs within the planning. And so we'll just conclude this section with this quote from a woman in Allegheny County saying that essentially you know, helping each other, that there's no better feeling, and that it gives you hope. And even though some of us are selfish, some of us are giving, and that's really powerful. So, and we'll turn it back to Andrea.
So I'm going to go ahead and talk about Region 5, and just wanted to show you all, for those of you who are not from Maryland and unfamiliar with that geography. So essentially, the little cutout of the white square is Washington, D.C. And so Region 5 is really kind of the counties that run along the border around the D.C. metro area, and then also Southern Maryland. So these are counties that are very much you know, exist sort of in relationship to Washington, D.C., but also things that we heard that I'll sort of mention is that, you know, in terms of sort of drug economy and other sort of patterns going on, you know, there are counties that also sort of exist very much in dialogue with what is happening within Washington, D.C. So for Region 5, I just wanted to give you a little bit of a breakdown of our sample characteristics, and in particular, give you a few highlights. So let me move this window here. Okay, so 56% of the sample is between the ages of 30 and 50. 36% of our sample was women. 57% of our sample identified as Black or African American, and 39% identified as white. 42% identified opioids as their drug of choice. And then 15% of those were people who inject drugs. So again, these demographics are really reflective of the dynamics sort of in the Washington, D.C. metro area. So I'll begin again using the sort of same format, which is to first sort of talk about some themes in relationship to drug use patterns and experiences of people who use drugs. So I'm going to talk about some broad themes that we found qualitatively, and then we'll do the sort of same exercise of, you know, looking at that theme and then tracking it with data, and then tracking it to recommendations. So some themes in relationship to drug use patterns and experiences was that there were extensive histories of trauma and intergenerational drug use. There was extensive stigmatization and criminalization in family, community, and provider networks. So really a narrative of being heavily policed and heavily, you know, criminalized around drug use. There were concentrated experiences with overdose and fentanyl in recent years. And so, you know, many of you may know, because there was a lot of national coverage, that the Washington, D.C. metro region experienced a, you know, pretty astronomical overdose death rate within the few years before we started the study. And then we also found that there were important considerations for Latinx and African American people who use drugs. So those are some of the broad themes to begin with. So again, wanted to sort of take you through, you know, if we have this theme, for instance, so just pulling out one theme of important considerations for Latinx and African American people who use drugs, then what are some of the ways that we then think through, you know, what the data looks like? And then what some of those recommendations that might emerge. So in terms of data, we found that there was, again, this intense impact of fentanyl and fentanyl-related deaths, specifically in the Black community. So there was a lot of discussion of the sort of trauma that had happened alongside with that overdose death sort of rates and sort of upswing that happened in the area. But there was feelings that this rapid intervention recently in response to overdose only took place when white communities were impacted. So some African-American communities were really hesitant to engage with the broader discussions about opioids and overdose prevention. And this was essentially existing in relationship to feelings of being excluded or overlooked historically as victims. So there was this narrative that this hyper-focus on the quote-unquote opioid epidemic in recent years would garner, you know, quote-unquote eye rolls from community members because people were really feeling that long-term experiences of drug use in Black communities had been ignored for decades. So one 40-year-old man in Prince George's County said, "We can go back and tell you how many people I lost. So I had a friend in my addiction. I woke up next to me dead. I woke up, he was dead next to me, dead. He died right next to me. My friend B died over fentanyl overdose. I lost like 3-4 people. Last year when my father, year before last, when my father died, I lost 7 people in the same year. I lost my grandmother." And so again, this is just kind of like a constellation of a lot of data. So again, we'll show you where you can access, you know, hundreds of pages of data for people to sort of look at the findings in greater depth. But this is just sort of one sampling that then sort of led us to our development of recommendations. So from this sort of theme, you know, we ultimately were sort of strategizing around, you know, that there needs to be a special consideration for how to respond to the impacts of fentanyl and overdose death on African-American populations in a place like Prince George's County. That, you know, potentially there was some room for community forums to discuss the perception that resources for overdose were only activated when it began to impact white Americans, and that this sort of dynamic needs to be addressed systematically. And that we really sort of needed to confront this issue that issues of historical exclusion and racism are essential to sort of cultivate trust and engagement with substance-related services. So with respect to service capacity and service gaps, some of the themes that we found were that there was a really valuing of peer recovery specialists and mobile services, but there was always a need for increased capacity. So people really saw and valued how having mobile services and peer recovery specialists were, but that because in some places these were sort of early programs, that there were not enough people, and that oftentimes those people also experienced constraints. We also saw that there was a lot of value in the community-based approaches that were delivered by people from the community. So again, people who might be, you know, natives in the counties that that they are working in, and that was extremely valuable. There was a lot of local expertise among people who use drugs. So lots of sort of, you know, thoughts about what it means to survive with an intense structural context, strategies, possibilities for collaboration. Similar to other regions, a lot of challenges with transportation. So again, a very geographically spread out area. So this kind of need to really reimagine what mobile services look like in the context of really widespread geographic areas. People describe challenges with accessing syringes. So, you know, despite people technically being able to legally access them, there were still all these other barriers in relationship to people actually being able to get them. And then also challenges with detoxification services, and in particular, detoxification services within incarceration settings were also something that people discussed quite broadly. So again, this is just another example. So if we were to take this theme of challenges with access to syringes, so what is some of the data that we have on that look like? So, you know, there technically were wider access to syringes, including at retail outlets. So at certain pharmacies of retail outlets, people were technically allowed to go in and purchase syringes. But people who use drugs still felt that stigma was a big factor. And one of the things that's really important, again, to bring out of this sort of finding is that, you know, again, you're dealing in context where, you know, you're not within Washington, D.C. necessarily, so don't really have the option of anonymity if you're going into a pharmacy or a drugstore or any kind of retail store. So everybody sort of knows you. And then for that reason, stigma and discrimination was a big factor in what happened once people would try to go and legally purchase syringes. So one person said when asked about syringe access, quote, if we wanted to go to this retail store and buy a box of 100 at a time at $13 a box, if they would sell them to you depending on who was there and if they gave a shit, also depending on who they, the person who used drugs, were. So a lot of people aren't even allowed to go to that retail store around here because they got caught stealing from there. So no, not really, not really. If blank is your only option, if you do not have a diabetic card and have a prescription for them, this retail store is not going to give them to you. And so again, thinking through this idea of, you know, even when we sort of implement policy that technically legislates that something is accessible, then there are all these other sort of mitigating social factors in relationship to stigma and discrimination that come into play. So a recommendation could be a need for outreach and education with the private sector retail stores and pharmacies that sell syringes. So despite, again, Maryland having this state law that authorizes the retail sale of syringes and needles without a prescription, and no direct prohibition on sales to people who use drugs, you know, we still find that there is an issue around training and compliance monitoring. So more of that is needed to ensure that retail establishments practices are actually in line with policy. Otherwise, people who use drugs end up effectively being excluded from laws that were essentially meant to serve a public health purpose. And so again, it's about sort of managing what exists as law and then how do things sort of exist in practice around sort of perceptions and ideologies that might be related to stigma and discrimination. Okay, and then so finally, in terms of the potential expansion of harm reduction services, we had similar themes with some nuances in relationship to the populations in Region 5. And so we had a lot, again, in relationship to the expertise and community expertise of people who use drugs and the expansion of harm reduction programming. So a lot of people that had perhaps been organizing around this issue in their community, long before, formal institutionalized kind of harm reduction practices had been in existence in the way they have been in recent years, but that a lot of people were actually, sort of practicing harm reduction at the community level, and the real need to think through what community expertise already exists as we really expand harm reduction programming. We heard the same thing around this need to expand peer-based and mobile services, but again, with the idea of those experts who have been doing work at the community level for a long time being that kind of source of how you might expand peer mobile and peer-based services. So again, not this sort of external imposition, but really a way of which, people internally could sort of get grown into these positions with the existing expertise that they've cultivated over decades. We also found the theme of the needs of people who use drugs, particular subpopulations within them. So again, Latinx and African American people who use drugs. And we also saw that there was a need for trust and coalition building with respect to the Good Samaritan law. So again, if we go through the exercise of taking the theme of this trust and coalition building with respect to the Good Samaritan law, and then think through some of the data that we have in our data set, and then what might be a recommendation. So of course, in Maryland, the Good Samaritan law exists, but we found that people still fear arrest tremendously or other negative outcomes from calling 911. And this was rooted not just in like a circulation of dialogue about fear, but rooted in people's experiences where they had had interactions with police previously when calling 911, where then they faced consequences and criminalization. So increased fear of calling 911 in the event of an overdose in our data set, especially among Black people who use drugs and community of color. So one participant described that after witnessing a friend's overdose, they said, quote, "Yes, I got out of there and dialed 911 because that means they're going to shake the whole house." So another participant who witnessed a man overdose called 911, but then the person who had collapsed also fled the area before the ambulance arrived. So quote, "2 days ago, a dude was standing up talking and he put his hands on the fence and all of a sudden he collapsed. And I knew what it was, called an ambulance, needed to come back by then. And he hauled it, I mean, he left." So again, here's another sort of place to really begin thinking about what, turning some of this data, things that, community members know and talk about in terms of, fears with calling 911. And thinking about, if we're sort of thinking through recommendations, like what is the action here? And I think oftentimes we tend to focus on sort of individual behavioral interventions with people who use drugs. But really what we're hearing here is there's sort of a more structural dynamic that is happening here in relationship to people's fear. So if more trust needs to be built, if we're really taking sort of the current moment in terms of our current historical moment of a racial reckoning in the US, then I think that means a sort of reframing of how we commonly ask questions and relationships to things like Good Samaritan law, which is not that more people who use drugs need education, but rather what does it mean to really build trust from a racial and social justice perspective, and how to build that accountability collectively when it is sort of indicative of a much broader systemic issue around people in vulnerable situations fearing calling 911.
So just in conclusion, we are happy to share that the summary of all of this work produced a series of different documents. And so for each county, there's a summary of county-specific findings. For each region, there's a summary of findings from a regional perspective. And then there's a full, I think, 400-page statewide report that includes all of that, and also a bit of a synthesis reflecting across the different regions. And all of that information is available in PDF form at the Google Drive link here. And this is the moment where I think maybe on behalf of both of us, there's no way that this project would have happened without the gazillions of people who were willing to participate, support, share their experiences, trust people that they'd never seen before, to be able to understand what's happening within their communities. So we're extremely grateful at the GHU side for our co-investigators, Becky Jemberg, Jilla Ocharczak, project directors, Julie Evans, Philip McNabb, Aaron Roth, and a gazillion other amazing people. And we'll highlight Andrew Bell's role in bringing us into this project for the start. And Andrea, I imagine you might want to say the same for your side of the slide here.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I think, you know, one of the things that was incredible is that, you know, we had 600 participants, over 600 participants in total, in an extremely sort of crunched timeline. You know, definitely want to thank my whole staff, who was absolutely stellar, including Dr. Cheryl Alipio, who is our lead analyst, Marwa El-Nasser, who's on this call right now, who is our project director, Maggie Ambrose, Zina Dot, Shane Sullivan, and Julia Tefereda, who is our Latinx service specialist. And then also, we had the absolute pleasure of being joined by three UMD anthropology research assistants, who are anthropology bachelors of science majors, Betsala Wandimu, Tajbik Sheikh, and Alex Brooks. And, you know, also just to sort of state that one of the things that is so wonderful about this, and I'm sure we can get into it a bit in Q&A, is that, you know, I really do encourage you all to, you know, make use of looking at those publicly accessible reports. So we produced a bunch of different deliverables for our counties and for others to look at, so that they could get sort of snapshots for their county and then also have access to the larger data sets. And so, you know, it is really nice, because there's often sort of this lag sometimes from research getting into the hands of people who might coordinate around implementation. But this is one of those moments in which, you know, the data through the Maryland Health Department became immediately publicly available in various ways that could be used as sort of advocacy tools or tools for considering next steps in implementation.
And just to acknowledge our funding and supports through the Maryland Department of Health and the team there was extremely useful and helpful through this process. I think that's our last slide.
I think we just have contact information on the next one in case anyone is interested. But obviously the NDUs and RUDA teams will be making this presentation accessible later. So
thank you so much. We will now begin the Q&A portion of this webinar. Please feel free to enter your questions in the Q&A box that's located at the bottom of your Zoom window. So the first question we have, describe how Maryland is working with rural EMS to respond to drug and opioid use and overdoses. Plus, how is Maryland using telehealth in rural counties for drug treatment?
I'll maybe start and just say that I think the to separate both of those questions. So the EMS providers are, I think, playing an incredible role in overdose response. And there's lots of different ways. So certainly they are first responders and from their voice are experiencing a lot of sort of pain and challenge in just those experiences and where that fits into the scope of their overall work. From a programmatic perspective, there is an increase in leave behinds of naloxone at settings where overdoses have happened, and a lot more engagement of EMS in sort of a direct response to and sort of a frontline prevention response in that regard. but certainly there's quite a lot of just kind of frontline interface at the point of overdose. And I think there's the EMS providers and people who use drugs have reflected quite a lot about how well that has worked and challenges that have been experienced in those interactions that I think are important to kind of reflect back on in thinking ahead to how to make that a sustainable and positive interaction for everyone involved going forward. Telehealth is something, so this is where the subtitle of a study done in 2019 becomes really important. So telehealth access to MAT was beginning to be available. It exists for infectious disease programming in certain counties, but if we were doing this study right now, the landscape has changed quite a bit. So it's one area where I think that our findings don't necessarily map onto what becomes available, but I think that it's certainly something that that helps to meet some of the transportation barriers for certain types of treatment and supports. And so we're hopeful that that expansion will be useful there. Andrea, I don't know if you want to add for either.
Yeah. Yeah, so I'll just add really quickly to the question about first responders. So I think, you know, one of the things that's so great about a qualitative study is that, you know, we got to speak extensively with first responders and really hear about them being sort of the people navigating, you know, the context of overdose within their own communities. So I think, you know, that's one of the sort of really profoundly important things is to hear voices from first responders about some of the challenges that they're navigating, the structural kind of things that might be impacting, you know, their ability to carry out the work at the highest level that they want to. So I think that's sort of one thing. Also in relationship to the telehealth and the sort of new landscape post-COVID, you know, I think there's been a huge movement in different community organizations, but different kind of drug user led organizing that has gone on to really think through a lot of the low threshold access for things like MAT via telehealth services. And there's often been a sort of pushback because a lot of people have a lot of hesitance to make these sort of services more low threshold. So now, you know, post-COVID, obviously there's a lot that has been sort of transformed. And now we sort of have proof of concept that, for instance, take home, you know, access to medication assisted treatment is actually a doable thing for people who use drugs. And so I think right now there's a very critically important kind of advocacy piece for thinking through as we've made a lot of these services more accessible post-COVID because of the need to do telehealth. How can we preserve that sort of telehealth landscape that is built up during the time of COVID to say that these are actually not just sort of pandemic related access issues, but that there really should be sort of baseline low threshold accessibility that people who might have issues in accessing services in any case should have all the time, regardless of the existence of the pandemic.
In regards to the topic of harm reduction expansion, was there any awareness by people who use drugs of overdose prevention centers, such as safe consumption sites, being proposed in Philadelphia and San Francisco?
I would say briefly, some, but not a lot. It came up more commonly among stakeholders who had sort of become aware of the breadth of things that might be considered harm reduction and tended to be followed with people's perceptions of what the potential political sort of viability might be within their region. It did come up among drug users, and it sort of interestingly in a caveat to say, so a little bit in regards to safe consumption sites in regards to Philadelphia and other places, but also there's been a dialogue within Maryland and within Baltimore specifically. So there's sort of a general familiarity of what's happening in which places, whether that might ever trickle out, whether it might ever be feasible in Baltimore, and whether it might ever trickle outside of Baltimore. So sort of a general awareness of that, but maybe more so an awareness of what's possible there and whether it ever might happen as something that I might have access to given where I am geographically.
And I would also just add that, you know, I think there, you know, to echo that, there was definitely an awareness, but given that this is sort of statewide and that different counties were in these different places with respect to, you know, having a syringe service program sort of up and running, I think there was some of that sort of dialogue around, you know, there's a whole sort of host of issues that could be addressed in this sort of broader commitment to implementing a harm reduction infrastructure. And so what are the sort of steps taken as people try to say, okay, well, we're going to, you know, be sure that we have, you know, equitable access to syringes or fentanyl test strips or naloxone. And then, you know, what are the sort of next steps as we build that step by step? So I think, you know, some people really felt that they were building things from the ground up in their own communities. And so aware, but also aware of this process that they were engaged in.
Terrific presentation. Very useful. Seems a lot like what we find in Southern Illinois. What themes emerged from interviews with EMTs and police?
I'll just say hi, Sam, and I feel like I'm answering all of the questions first. So Andrea, if you want to jump in first.
I don't mind going back and forth, but either way. So I think, you know, we, you know, again, the report is quite extensive, and so definitely highly encourage people to sort of take a look. You know, I think, again, it's sort of consistent with what we've been talking about, which is this you know, extreme usefulness of qualitative research to be able to really dive into what are people's experiences at the front lines extensively. And so, you know, I think people are in a very tough position structurally to have to sort of, you know, enforce at the same time as they are frontline responders to the U.S. overdose crisis. And so I think, you know, a lot of sort of negotiation of being in a position where, you know, frontline providers in the case of police are maybe responding to things that, you know, are health emergencies that are going on and sort of what that means. And so, you know, I think one of the things also about our timeline is that, you know, these are all sort of preliminary sort of moments to say, okay, if there's a particular local context that really needs sort of more investigation around what is happening at that interface of frontline providers or first responders, then this is sort of the beginning of catalyzing a sort of longer, a deeper study. Because again, within our sort of composition of stakeholders, we had some law enforcement and some first responders, but not a tremendous amount, obviously, because of the different sort of sampling strategy that we were engaged in.
So I'm going to jump in for a moment. I just want to say thank you, Dr. Germain and Dr. Lopez, for your great presentation today. You really raised a number of powerful themes and important issues for all of us to think about, including the value and the importance of in addressing and including the PWUT and community expertise when developing and implementing harm reduction strategies and treatment protocols and so on. And we've got a number of really great questions coming in. So we will continue on with the Q&A for those of you who can continue to join the conversation. But I also want to let you know a little bit about our two upcoming webinars. We have two more coming up this month on the next slide here. And one is an NDUS webinar and the other is a Maryland ROTA webinar. And the NDUS Presents webinar will feature our CSER NDUS Coordinating Center PI, Dr. Eric Wish, and he will be speaking on the remembrance of things past using your analysis results to monitor emerging drug use from Duff to EDS. EDS is the Emerging Drug Surveillance System that we have recently launched with several hospitals in Maryland. And that will be followed in August by a Maryland ROTA webinar from a group of speakers led by Sandy Miller, the Alcohol and Other Drug Abuse Prevention Supervisor at the Garrett County Health Department. And they will be speaking about the Garrett County response to the opioid epidemic. So keep an eye on the network for information about registering for those and our two websites. And we hope that we'll see you there. And just as a reminder, we will be making a recording of this webinar and the slides available on both of the websites at ndews.org and marylandrota.org. So Laura, I'll let you get back to the questions.
The next question is, what are ways for communities to gather similar local level data, especially if they don't have the level of investment that this study had?
We talked a lot about this because it felt like in some ways, what I'll say is that a lot of this insight does exist within the local level, and what became clear is creating this conversation spaces for bringing all of the different people and perspectives into the same space to think together about things. So they're in, you know, report backs with, you know, health department teams. There, a lot of times the reflections were, a lot of this are things that we've heard before, but there's specificity and there's sort of local voices in this that give richness and examples that we can use and sort of think and talk about. So what we ended up talking a lot about is just creating the spaces for conversation. So for people who are running programs, who are wondering what it is that people who use drugs might be feeling or thinking about their program, to just sit down next to them and ask them, and to sort of just create the space for conversation. There's, you know, much more to say, but I think that that just resonated really clearly in our conversations, is just that there are lots of people who want to share, and just creating the mechanisms for doing that, even really informally, can be extremely valuable.
Yeah, and I guess I would just add to that, you know, this was definitely meant as sort of the beginning of a sort of long process of what it looks like to, you know, always include people who use drugs, and understanding what a landscape and state services look like, and also understanding what the expansion of services might look like. So I think, again, sort of the beginning of having a data set that also includes the voices of people who use drugs, a sort of primary way that we developed our findings, and then say, okay, so what might next steps be to ensure that these voices of those who are most directly impacted are always included in how policy is created, how programs are implemented? I will say too that there is, you know, a wide array, again, of community organizations that are led by people who use drugs all across the country that are really modeling this type of behavior for us. And so, you know, there's a bunch of drug users unions, there's San Francisco Drug Users Union, there's the Urban Survivors Union, there's Be More Power in Baltimore, just a bunch of community organizing driven by people who use drugs and others impacted by drug use. And so, you know, there's all of these sort of existing models for what a, you know, from the ground community-based movement looks like. And then also how that might interface with, you know, researchers like us, you know, who might be doing sort of work in the same area.
Next question, was this work funded by Maryland to carry its insights forward and to continue to update it?
Not at present.
Yeah, so this, the initial phase was funded, the data collection, obviously, and then we've got the reports. And I think, you know, sort of moving through then thinking like, what are the best ways to support the work getting carried forward towards implementation stages or to other things? I think that's sort of, you know, in the works and in the hopes for next steps.
What about facilitating online sales of syringes? This may help.
There definitely were a lot of conversations about, you know, what are the various mechanisms that just would support better access in lots of different ways. And so conversations about, mail order, home delivery, essentially, are definitely part of the conversations. And I think, in fact, are sort of fitting in with the kind of the progression of harm reduction resources. There's also, you know, I think the thought was, in broad brush, how to create options that meet lots of different people's needs. And so, you know, there are jurisdictions that that have moved quite far forward with different versions of syringe service programs and are able to meet a variety of different needs and sort of build relationships and do some coalition building in ways that that would be missed with a solely mail order type approach, but absolutely with the geographic range and the transportation challenges and all of that, there's definitely a space for direct delivery that I think could could meet a lot of people's needs.
And I would also just add, I think, you know, that sort of question kind of points to this way in which, you know, we have to sort of confront and also reckon with how, you know, sort of public health best practices. So things that are sort of in the evidence base around syringe access, around access to naloxone, around low threshold treatment access. You know, we have to kind of also negotiate the sort of territory of the way in which our own kind of moral ideas intersects public health and best practices in public health. So I think, you know, the mail order syringe question, right, is if we were thinking from sort of a wholly kind of public health perspective, it could be part of this sort of idea of, you know, low threshold access to services in relationship to drug use. But it also means that we really have to conceptualize this not as drug use siloed from broader kind of health models, but really work through sort of thinking through, you know, we're talking about people who might experience vulnerabilities and overall approaches to health, which may include some of these harm reduction strategies. And so I think it really requires us sort of confronting, you know, how we envision health, how we envision health for people who use drugs, and how we really sort of envision making things accessible that have sort of been shown in the evidence base to be beneficial from a public health perspective.
You mentioned that your research identified gaps in the availability of residential treatment programs. Do your reports highlight or have recommendations on which types of treatment programs are most needed by jurisdiction, by SAM level, for example?
So to some extent, what I think comes clear in each county report is what their particular gaps are and what emerged notably from the perspective of people who use drugs, of what they have access to, and then some stakeholder perspectives on what they thought that people thought that they had access to and what some of that mismatch is. So there is some reflection on, in this county, they are lacking absolutely this specific type of program. And we didn't necessarily go into a sort of full like matrix type of approach of what all of the possibilities might be, but let the sort of voices of respondents come clear in what specifically they were missing in their jurisdictions. And that definitely is clear in the county and in the reports across the different levels that we tackled that.
And I would also just add that that also includes thinking through detox services when someone is incarcerated. So there's a lot of perspective and experiences from people who use drugs talking about what it's like to be incarcerated and then what sort of detoxification services are in existence. And so I think in that range, again, just sort of captured that experience as well.
Will there be a SEEDS 2.0 to explore themes and or graphic patterns in more detail?
Hi, Kathy, and hi, Stephanie. it was really clear when we, even in the midst of doing this work, that that even though it has such a broad scope and was so much to accomplish, that there's so much more. And in particular, having that sort of point in time richness of what's happening really then calls into sort of bear, how does that change? And particularly, how does that change after or in the midst of the type of historic change that has happened since we did this work? So there's so much more that I think that we wish that we could have explored even within this, and thinking about it from a kind of temporal change perspective, lots more that could be done for sure.
Just to echo that you know, it really signals the importance and the sort of usefulness of trying to build long-term collaborative relationships with people, so that, you know, let's say for instance, you know, something sort of begins to emerge in a community that is a question of interest, you know, that there can be sort of ongoing engagement between researchers and people on the ground who are doing this kind of work. And so I think, you know, the goal is always, yes, to continue, but I think, you know, at the moment we're still sort of thinking through what that might look like.
I don't have the slides in front of me, but if I remember correctly, there were more interviews with stakeholders in Wicomico County compared to others. Any particular reason?
Yes, that is the question that always comes up whenever anybody sees that slide. That was the first county that we worked in on the Eastern Shore. One, we got really excited and wanted to talk to everyone and realized quite quickly that within our timeline that wouldn't be possible or wouldn't be possible on the same scale everywhere that we were working, but also because it was the first work that we were doing on the shore and in particular on the lower shore, there's a lot of sort of cross-jurisdictional work. And so a lot of the stakeholders based there were also quite helpful in understanding the landscape across the lower shore and sort of across the shore in general. But we just weren't able to do that degree of depth as we continued forward.
If stigma and the collision of moralistic and public health approaches are significant problems, what are tools and approaches that you recommend to address stigma?
Well, I think, you know, there's obviously sort of like a multitude of different tools. I know in some of the recommendations there are linked some, anti-stigma, anti-discrimination tools that are actually being built by, coalitions and community organizations of people who use drugs. So even some stuff around language, right? So saying substance use instead of substance abuse. So there's a lot of sort of organization that we've linked in some of the recommendations around stigma. So there's a campaign called Reframe the Blame, which also includes even interfacing with media to say, how are we reporting on drug-related issues in our communities? And what are the ways in which these things often tend to reinforce and stigmatize communities in terms of the even reporting? So I think there's a lot of national resources like that. I think if we're thinking on the local level in terms of our findings, that's one of the sort of exciting things about working in every single county and then producing county-specific results is that, you know, these things play out very differently in different places based on whether something is more rural, whether it's urban, whether it's suburban. And so I think there's different kind of mechanisms for stigma and discrimination within these different contexts. And so, you know, the qualitative findings are really able to point to and say, okay, what might be a mechanism for stigma in your community that people pointed out? And then that sort of opens up the conversation to discussing kind of at the local level, what would some of these other broader stigma, anti-stigma campaigns that have gone on, would they be helpful in this local context? Or do we need to sort of rethink, what something like this might look like as implemented in a local context? So I think a little bit of both those things, there are best practices and then, the richness of stigma at a local level. So for instance, this is just an example, but like if one pharmacy is really responsible for stigmatization in relationship to purchasing syringes, then that's a very localized conversation that needs to happen about, local people serving as gatekeepers when there's policy in place to ensure that people can access syringes at a pharmacy setting. So that's an example of a really localized version. So I think it really requires the back and forth of that kind of national best practices, but then the sort of local needs and local issues.
One more question. Could you discuss the safe disposal of used syringes? I recently had about 30 syringes and two pharmacies refused to accept them. Someone told me I should take them to the police department.
It may vary a little bit within jurisdiction. So certainly if you're in a jurisdiction that has certain service programs, then that's a great option. There's the recommendation to bring to fire statement stations, sort of hospitals, that type of thing. And then there's also just a lot of best practices for safe disposal. Having containers that are not able to be punctured, like laundry detergent containers, and then making sure that makes its way into a trash receptacle that doesn't create any additional concern.
Yeah, I think the question really depends on where someone is and if they have access to certain service program, and then if not, again, like, are they somewhere urban, somewhere rural? I think that the question really sort of depends on the very specifics of where they're at. So that I think it has different answers depending on those variables.
Thanks again, Dr. Lopez and Dr. Germain, for a great presentation. And I just want to let everyone know who's still here that Marilyn Rota will be sending a follow-up email with a satisfaction survey. So we would really appreciate your participation and feedback. And we thank everyone for attending today's webinar, and we hope to see you in our future events. And I hope everyone has a great rest of their day.
Thank you, everyone. We hope to see you at our upcoming webinars on July 28th for NDUS Presents with Dr. Eric Wish, and in August for the group of speakers at the upcoming Maryland-Rota webinar for Garrett County. Have a good day.